الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد. We begin our class this evening with some review of our previous class. بإذن الله تعالى وبعونه سبحانه وتعالى مع عنوان هذه الرسالة التي ندرسها. What's the title of the treatise we're studying? القواعد الأربع. القواعد الأربع. Who is the author? الشيخ محمد ابن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله تعالى. When was he born? Eleven? 15. When did he die? 1206. Ahsant. Allahumma barak. Allahumma barak. Naam. He began his treatise Al-Qawa'id Al-Arba'. Or before that, the title Al-Qawa'id Al-Arba'. What is the meaning of Al-Qawa'id? Principles. The plural of Qa'ida, the foundation, the fundamental principle, the base of something. Like the foundation of a building is called Qa'idatuhu. Naam wa asluhu wa asasuhu. So here the author, he is establishing four foundations, four principles in the clarification of what are these foundations clarifying? What is he establishing upon these principles? Abdullah? Ahsant. Allahumma barak. Allahumma barak. He's establishing with these four principles the clarification between the difference. The difference between the religion of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the religion of the idol worshippers, the religion of the pagans, the polytheists. He is clarifying in these four fundamental principles the difference between Tawheed and Shirk, the difference between the deen of Al-Islam and the deen of the Mushrikeen, the difference between the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the way of those who associate partners with Allah azza wa jal. This is what the treatise is about. These four fundamental principles, they clarify in detail the deen of the Mushrikeen, making it clear by understanding the deen of the Mushrikeen, the deen of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Naam, the deen of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So these four principles clarify for the one who learns them by the permission of Allah Azza wa Jalla the difference between Tawheed, the deen of Tawheed, and the difference between the deen of the Mushrikeen, the deen of Shirk, the way of the polytheist, and the difference between true Islamic monotheism and the difference between associating partners with Allah Azza wa Jalla in worship. Naam, the difference between associating partners with Allah Azza wa Jalla in worship. The author began with the Basmala. Who remembers the reason for that? He began with the Basmala. What does that mean? He began with saying, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Naam. Al-Istiana. First, seeking Allah's help. Where was that at? The ulama, they mentioned by beginning with the Basmalah, there's two benefits. One of them, the brother he mentioned, Jazallahu khayru al-istiyana, seeking aid and seeking help by beginning with the name of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Also, seeking barakah and blessing, seeking goodness and an increase in goodness. Al-barakah, al-khayr, wa ziyada fi khayr, wa ziyadatu al-khayr, wa namu. Barakah, seeking blessing. So the one, he begins with the basmala or with the tasmiyah according to his situation, seeking the aid of Allah Azza wa Jal. So to say Bismillah or to say Bismillahir Rahman Rahim, this is at the time the tongue is saying that, the heart is doing what? Thinking about something that happened yesterday. La. Whenever the one is saying Bismillah, what is his heart doing? Huh? Aywa. But specifically, this is a kalima adistiana, the statement of seeking help. The heart is depending and relying upon Allah Azza wa Jalla. The heart is making tawakkul and asking for help, relying and depending, hoping in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help him. That's why he said his name. He mentioned his name. He did the deed that he's doing with his name, seeking his help. Seeking his help because he knows that he is a slave and servant and that he is weak. And if Allah does not help him, then there's no help for him. If Allah does not help him, there's no help for him. So then he remembers his reality and he remembers his Lord. And he asks for help. Bismillah. And whatever he does. So at this time, it's not just a statement on the tongue that we should become accustomed to without having a meaning, but rather it's a great statement. And it is a statement on the tongue, no doubt. But along with that, there is the action of the heart. Asking Allah, hoping for the help of Allah. It's a statement of al-istiana, karimatul istiana, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Asking Allah to help and also seeking His blessing. Seeking His blessing. So then the basmala, a person, he makes the statement of the basmala or the tasmiya, hoping for two things. What are they? The help of Allah Azza wa Jal and the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal. The help comes from, where did the ulama derive the understanding of seeking help? From this word, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. From the ba. The ba is called harf al-jar. And the ulama, they mentioned that this ba is ba al-isti'ana, the ba of seeking aid and help and assistance. We mentioned some examples from that yesterday in the class. Kitabtu bil-qalam wa qata'tu bil-sikkin. This is ba al-isti'ana. Bismillahi aktubu wa bismillahi ashrabu wa bismillahi akulu wa hakada. Seeking with the help of Allah Azza wa Jalla, I eat. With the help of Allah, seeking the aid of Allah, I drink. With the help and the permission, seeking His blessing, subhanahu wa ta'ala, I drive my car or do the deed that I do. And in this case, the author, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, aktubu, aktubu. Or for us, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, naqra'u. We read, seeking the name, seeking the aid and the help of Allah Azza wa Jal and His blessing by beginning with His name. So that if we see this and understand that a believer, he will see that he has a great gem and treasure with him. By remembering the name of Allah Azza wa Jal, the basmala or the tasmiyah, this is a statement that is valuable and beneficial in the life of a believer. But that's whenever he states it and he understands its meaning and he uses it properly, that he moves his tongue and his heart at the same time. And this is a general benefit that we should be aware of with the recitation of the Qur'an and likewise with the adhkar, the other adhkar, in the morning and in the evening, that they are strong and that they are a means for protection. يُحَصِّنُ الْمُسْلِمُ بِذِكْرِهَا وَبِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ عَزِّ وَجَلْ فِيهَا. That a Muslim, he will fortify himself by the adhkar in the mornings and the evenings and after the salawat. But this, whenever he uses his tongue along with his heart. So the basmala is a very beneficial statement for a believer to state. Here the author, he began. Does he have, who is he following in this methodology? Beginning with the basmala. He's following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As for example, we've seen in the class yesterday that he wrote a letter to Hiraqal. Naam, and he mentioned in the very beginning, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. From Muhammad, the slave of Allah and his messenger, to Hiraqal. In this manner, likewise, even before following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, following Sulaiman likewise. And before following Sulaiman alayhi salatu wa sallam, likewise, following the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. The book of Allah, Ahsantum. The book of Allah Azza wa Jal, it began like this. And even the chapters of Allah Azza wa Jal, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would know that a new chapter was being revealed whenever Jibreel alayhi salam would come with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So the chapters would begin in this manner, and this is how Allah Azza wa Jal, he began his revelation. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So the author, he is following the way of Allah Azza wa Jal in his book, and he's following the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and following likewise the way of the prophets before him, such as Sulaiman alayhi salam. Likewise, we've seen the benefits from Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, that both of these are from the names of Allah Azza wa Jal, his most beautiful names, min asma'ihi al-husna, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, and they indicate a great and lofty attribute of Allah Azza wa Jal. Which attribute is that? Ar-Rahma, Ar-Rahma, mercy. Ar-Rahma, the attribute of mercy. But there's a slight difference that the ulama they mentioned with regards to understanding these two names. Who can remember that and remind us? Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. Both of them, they indicate the sifa or the attribute of Allah Azza wa Jalla, that He is merciful, that He has the attribute of mercy, great mercy, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there's a difference between Ar-Rahman, the mercy here that is intended in Ar-Rahim. For the believers, ahsant. وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. The ulama, they mentioned that the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla is two types, a general, all-encompassing mercy, and this is from the mercy of Ar-Rahman, that everything in this life, it has the from the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla, it's in existence, and it has provision, all by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and by His knowledge and by His wisdom. But there is a specific type of mercy that Allah, He has for special individuals from His creation, from the special individuals that He has selected and chosen. This is the mercy, Ar-Rahma Al-Khasa. What mercy is that? Shaykh Abdul Razak, we've seen a benefit from his statement yesterday. Hafidhahullah, Rahmatun Imaniyah. Rahmatun Imaniyah is the mercy of Al-Iman. Rahmatun Imaniyah, wa Rahmatun Hidayah, wa Tawfiq. Naam, إلى الإسلام والعمل بشرع الدين. It is the mercy that Allah Azza wa Jalla, He gives servants whom He wills from His slaves, the mercy of Iman, and believing in Him, and knowing Him, and drawing near to Him, and worshipping Him in a manner that is pleasing to Him. Many of the creation, they do not have this mercy. They do not have this mercy. This is a mercy that is specific for the believers. كَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. كَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. Rather, this is why He sent His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and He revealed His book. In this manner, Allah Azza wa Jalla, He mentioned, هُوَ الَّذِي يُنَزِّلُ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ آيَاتٍ بَيِّنَاتٍ لِيُخْرِجَكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ بِكُمْ لَرَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. That He is very kind and merciful. Allah, He says in His book that it is He, Allah Azza wa Jalla, who sent His or revealed to His slave, meaning Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, clear signs and proofs, yani the Qur'an, clear signs and proofs, evidences, ayat, bayinat. He mentioned the wisdom behind that likewise in this verse, that he sent this Qur'an to Allah, to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, liyukhrijakum, to bring you out, to bring the people out, the believers, those who He has preferred with that rahma imaniyah, to bring you out from that darkness into the light. From the darkness into the light. What a great kindness and mercy. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ بِكُمْ لَرَؤُوفُ الرَّحِيمُ. In verity, Allah is very kind and merciful. And this is the greatest of mercy and kindness, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would bring a person from the darkness of disbelief, and from the darkness of rebellion and rejection of belief, and from the darkness of disobedience and corruption, from the darkness of the evil, of ignorance, and from the darkness of misguidance and deviation, and from the gardens of the darkness of innovation, to the light of al-Islam and the Sunnah, to the light of al-Salafiyya al-Sahiha, to the light of al-Sirat al-Mustaqim, to the light of al-Ilm al-Nafi' wal-Amal al-Salih. This, إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِكُمْ لَرَؤُوفُ الرَّحِيمُ. Allah is very, very nice and kind, and very, very merciful to you. This is a great, great mercy that a believer, he should show thanks. That a believer, he should show thanks, especially if he takes the ibrah and he looks around him, especially in the environment that we live in specifically, and we see the reality of many of the people. How far are they from the mercy of from this great mercy? If you just drive down the street outside, you'll see liquor stores, and you'll see this store and that store, and stores where they're providing interest and riba and loans that are impermissible, left and right, and left and right, and left and right. A person, if he is not careful, he would think, how could one ever be guided? But it's from the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla, surrounded in all of this darkness and surrounded in all of this evil and wickedness. All of these things are contrary to the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jalla. All of these things that the people are upon here are upon the ones who die upon that way. These ways lead to the hellfire and no other place. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He would raise a person from that. And He would take a person from that. And He would guide him to the Tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and allow him to know His names and attributes, and allow him to read His book and understand. What a great mercy. إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِكُمْ لَرَؤُوفُ الرَّحِيمُ. That this is very, very, very kind, and very, very, very great mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How can a believer keep that mercy? And how can a believer, if he wants, now that he knows that his Lord is merciful, how can he get the mercy? Is there a way to obtain it? Is there a way to seek the mercy from Allah Azza wa Jalla, to ask for an increase? By obedience. By obedience. These are usul. And the actual text here is going to go into detail about, as we mentioned, the difference between the deen of the mushrikeen and the deen of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But here, if we pay attention and we look into the introduction, although it's brief, we see and we ponder over some of these terms and the methodology of the author, we see that the deen of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is clear. He's clarifying just in his supplication for the reader how the proper way to make tawassul, which is one of the shubuhat of those mushrikeen and the deen of the mushrikeen, that you make tawassul with the names of Allah Azza wa Jal, by calling on Allah Azza wa Jal and hoping in Allah Azza wa Jal, and then you ask Him for what you want. This is the correct way. And then he's mentioning likewise the proper deen of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all times and all states, the deen of al-hanifiyyah. And so before we go through the text in detail or the actual intent from the author, I would like to discuss these points in detail, because these are usul that a believer, they should be with him and he should be aware of them. These terms here should be a foundation and a fundamental principle in the heart of every believer, and he should be using them and knowing them and understanding them, striving against his soul to apply them. Bismillah. He doesn't say it just fruitlessly. Rather, he says it and he hopes for the help of Allah Azza wa Jal. He says it and he hopes for the help of Allah Azza wa Jal. His relationship with Allah is strong. He's not far from the remembrance of his Lord. He's not far from the remembrance of his Lord. This way a believer can be good and beneficial in this life. And he can die upon what is pleasing to Allah Azza wa Jal. And he can have a good ending. So many people, they don't have good endings. But a believer, this is what he hopes for. And this is the greatest, greatest, greatest honor from Allah Azza wa Jal, to die upon piety, to die upon obedience, to die upon the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, the way to obtain the mercy of Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim is to obey Him. To obey Him. Many Muslims, they have a false understanding. Allah, they know these names. Ar-Rahman, even another name they know Him by, Al-Ghafoor. Al-Ghafoor Rahim, He's forgiving and merciful. That's right, He's forgiving, He's the most forgiving, and He's the most merciful. But He has made a means for a believer to take, to obtain that mercy and to obtain that forgiveness. And the means to obtain the mercy of Allah is not by disobeying Him. The means of obtaining the forgiveness of Allah is not by blatantly disobeying Him and going against His commandments, but rather by obeying Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and by obeying His Messenger. For example, Allah, He says, clarifying this, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَأَتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Listen to, this is what Allah's commands, establish the prayer and establish the zakat, the pillars of Islam, establish the deen, and obey the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ, so that you can have mercy. So that you can have mercy. So the mercy, a person, he will obtain that from Allah Azza wa Jal by striving to obey Him. By striving to obey Him. By striving to obey Him. Likewise, he mentioned another name. He began making tawassul in this manner, seeking nearness to Allah Azza wa Jal. Tawassala ilayhi bidhikri asma'ihi wa thana'i alayhi bidhikri asma'ihi. That he's seeking nearness to Allah Azza wa Jal before he supplicates, by praising Him and mentioning the names of Allah Azza wa Jal and His attributes. He said, As'alullaha al-Kareem. Al-Kareem. Rabbil Arshil Azeem. Before that, quick review. Ma mana Allah? What's the meaning of Allah? That was one very important point from class yesterday. The meaning of Allah. We maybe said it was 4 or 5 words. Al-ilah al-haq. That's the meaning where it was derived from. Al-ilah. Sah. But there was a statement of a companion that was narrated by a scholar of tafsir. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. And who was the scholar who narrated it? At-Tabari. Ahsantuma. Naam. What? At-Tabari, sah? Naam. With his chain to Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. And he said the meaning of Allah is? Ajma أحسنت اللهم بارك ذو الألوهية والعبودية على خلقه أجمعين. That he is the one who possesses the ألوهية, the divinity, يعني the attributes of perfection, no deficiency whatsoever in his names and attributes سبحانه وتعالى, deserving to be worshipped alone. ذو الألوهية, deserving to worship, to be worshipped of alone. So he has likewise العبودية, he's also ذو العبودية, and he deserves to be worshipped because he has the attributes of perfection and because he has the traits of كمال, أوصاف الكمال وصفات الكمال سبحانه وتعالى. No deficiency whatsoever, not in his life or in his knowledge or in his wisdom or in any of his names and attributes, in his mercy and his hearing and his seeing. سبحانه وتعالى ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير لم يكن له كفوا أحد. سبحانه وتعالى هو الذي يطعم ولا يطعم. He feeds and he's not fed. He does not ask for us to feed him or provide for him. لا يسألكم رزقا. He doesn't ask for provision. Even no one benefits him, even if we obey him, and no one harms him if we disobey him. It is only us that benefit with his obedience, and it is us that is harmed from disobeying him. He's powerful and strong, and everyone is in need of him, and he is in need of nothing. Al-Ahad al-Samad, subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is Allah. That is who Allah is. Dhul uluhiyya, the one who possesses the divinity, and the divine attributes of perfection, requiring or necessitating that he be worshipped alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dhul uluhiyyati wal-ubudiyyati ala khalqihi ajma'in. Naam, this was the meaning of Allah. So he began by mentioning, asking, I ask Allah, calling on Allah, not on the idols and not on the prophets and not on the creation and anything else, but rather calling on the creator of the creation, using his greatest name, Allah. As'alullah al-Kareem. Al-Kareem, also another one of the names of Allah Azza wa Jal. Al-Kareem. What is the meaning of Al-Kareem? Huh? The noble. From the meanings of Al-Karam is nobility. Likewise, so Allah, he is the most noble. But also the meaning of Al-Karam or Al-Kareem, huh? The one who gives a lot. Gives and gives and gives. He has a lot of good. The one who is Kareem, the one who is generous, he has lots and lots of good. Lots and lots of good. Lots and lots of good. Kathirul khair. Kathirul khair. Kathirul khair wal ata. He is the one who is giving all the time. Giving and giving. He's Kareem. He's generous. He's kind. He's generous. Giving over and over and over and over. Even if the people don't give. Or even if the people disobey. Or even if the people disbelieve. He gives them. He gives them. He gives them. He's generous and kind. He gives them. Time, he gives them. Family, he gives them. If you ask, he gives them. Also from these names, Al-Akram. Al-Akram. These names have come in the Quran. Ya ayyuhan nas, ma gharraka bi rabbika al-kareem. Iqra' wa rabbuka al-Akram. The most generous. He's the most generous. He gives and gives and gives. Even if we disobey him, he gives and gives and gives. And when we obey him, he gives more. وَإِذْ تَأَدَّنَ رَبُّكُمْ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you show thanks, then I'll give you more, he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he is very kind and he's very generous and he gives and he gives and he gives. Al-Kareem, subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is very beneficial for a believer to know. This is the deen of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, calling on the Kareem. Remembering that all of this good that I have, it come to me from Al-Kareem. All of the nobility that I have in this life, all of the wealth that I have, even my eyesight, all of these blessings is from from Al-Kareem, from Ar-Rahman, from Ar-Rahim. The iman that I have, I prayed salah today, Alhamdulillah, Ar-Rahim, Ar-Rahimani. He showed me mercy. It's not from my favor, not from my bounty, not from my blessing. I woke up and prayed. I remembered him, Alhamdulillah. A believer, this is the deen of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, remembering Allah Azza wa Jalla, knowing him by his names and attributes. That's why we were created to know him. We were created to know him. This is tawheed, tawheed al-ilmi. Tawheed al-ilmi. There's tawheed al-ilmi, tawheed al-asma'i wa sifat, tawheed al-rububiyya. This is the intent from tawheed al-rububiyya and the intent from tawheed al-asma'i wa sifat. What is al-maqsood min dhalik? Al-ma'rifat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to know him. To know him, to know him, to know that he is the creator and the sustainer and the provider. To know him by his rububiyya and from his creation. To know him from his legislation likewise. Lahu al-khalqu wal-amr. Lahu al-khalqu wal-amr subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the tawheed of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So a believer, he shouldn't be deceived. He shouldn't be tricked. He let him learn about his Lord. Let him know his religion. Let him know Allah Azza wa Jalla bi tawheedihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bi tawheedihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. As'alullah al-kareem. He says, I ask Allah al-kareem. Knowing that Allah Azza wa Jalla, He gives. Ask Him. He gives. He gives. Every believer knows that. How many times did a believer he ask? He knows the karam of Allah Azza wa Jalla. How generous He is. How many times did he ask for a new job? Or how many times did he ask for help? Or how many times did he ask for a wife? And then he asked for a child. And then he asked for another child. And then he asked for some wealth. And he asked and he asked. How many times did it come? How many times did he respond? He responds. Udu'uni astajib lakum. Call on me and I'll respond. Why? He's Kareem. He's Rahman. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you believe in Him, He will give you even more. If you show thanks for your belief, He will give you steadfastness. In shakaratum lazidannakum. The greatest thing we should thank Allah Azza wa Jalla for is knowing Him. Is knowing Him. Is knowing Him. That's the greatest blessing. As it's been mentioned by Ibn Uyayna rahimahullah ta'ala, that the greatest blessing, a'azam ni'mah, an arrafa an-nasa la ilaha illallah. That He caused, that He allowed the people to know the statement la ilaha illallah. He allowed them to know the meaning of the statement la ilaha illallah. Naam, this is the greatest blessing. Alhamdulillah. We thank Allah Azza wa Jalla. We thank Him and we praise Him. And we ask Him to make us steadfast and firm. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah li tawheedi wa sunnah. Alhamdulillah li hadha ad-deen. As the people in Jannah say, what do they say? Alhamdulillah alladhi hadana li hadha. وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله أسأل الله الكريم. He says رب العرش العظيم. This is tawheed. This is the tawheed of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather, there are many narrations where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would make dua similar like this, and he would call on Allah azza wa jal even before sleeping, or even in the mornings when he would call on Allah azza wa jal and mention the rububiyyah of Allah and the lordship of Allah and His throne. Naam. اللهم رب السماوات السبع ورب الأرض ورب العرش العظيم. Before sleeping, min athkar al-nawm, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would make this like this, and the same, calling on Allah and mentioning His rububiyyah and the rububiyyah, the lordship of His throne. Wa rabbil arsh al-azim. Likewise, in the athkar in the morning, you will find similar like this, calling on Allah azza wa jal and praising Him and making tawassul ilayhi subhanahu wa ta'ala by mentioning the lordship of His throne. Just as the author here, that many people, they claim he's misguided and he came with a new deen, but when we look at it, he's upon the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's upon the tawheed, and he's upon the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is an occasion he wants good for those who read his book. As'alullah al-kareem, rabbal arshil azim. This other word here, Ar-Rabb, from the names of Allah Azza wa Jal. Ar-Rabb. This is a great, great, great name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rabb. Indicating His rububiyyah, His lordship over His creation. Ar-Rububiyyah, the ulama, they mentioned that this entails three issues. Al-Mulku wal-Khalqu, or al-Khalqu wal-Mulku wal-Tadbir. That Allah Azza wa Jal, He is the creator of all things. He's the Rabb. What is the Rabb? Ar-Rabb hu al-Khaliq. Al-Malik, Al-Mudabbir, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, Al-Mutasarrifu fi hadha al-kawn. He is the creator, He's the one who created all things. Al-Khaliq, Al-Bari, He's the creator of all things, and He is the originator of all things, everything. Air, where did it come from? Allah created air. Air that we breathe, He created it, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. He created air. Somebody has a thought. You have a thought. You have an idea. What are you thinking about? Who created this? خَلَقَكُمْ وَمَا تَعْلَمُونَ وَمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. He created you and what you do. All things. These are from the creation of Allah Azza wa Jal. He is the Khaliq. خَالِقُ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. This is the Lord that we worship. And He is the one who is worthy of worship. He is the creator. He is the rububiyyah. He is the Rabb. He is the creator of all things. Not only that, He is the one who brought everything into existence. Before there was nothing, it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هُوَ الْأَوَّلُ لَيْسَ قَبْلَهُ شَيْءٌ. There was Him, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, the Lord, the Rabb, and He created all things, and that means that everything that He created is under His command. He has the authority. He has the authority. By His command, the sun comes up, and by His command, the sun goes down, and by His command, the souls, they come to life in the wombs of the women. And by His command, they come out. And by His command, the people die. And by His command, the people, they will be resurrected again. And He did not create this creation for nothing or for a purpose. Rather, for a great purpose. For a great purpose. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, lahu al-mulk. He has the dominion in His hand, and everything belongs to Him. The one who has the ownership, this has the meaning also of authority. This has the meaning of authority. The one who owns something, he has authority over that thing. Like, for example, I own this phone. What would happen if somebody took this phone without my permission to use it? To use it without my permission. They violated. This is oppression. This is oppression. What about it, since it's mine, I have authority over it, I can let somebody use it, but I can even make restrictions. You can use it, but only for this. Or you can use it, but only at this time. If he use it under my permission, he's safe from blame. But if he used the phone for something other than I allowed him to use it for, then what? He's blameworthy. He has oppressed. He had violated. He transgressed the boundaries. This is the meaning of ownership. The one who has ownership. The one who has ownership, he has authority. Allah Azza wa Jalla lahu al-mulk. Malikul mulk. Malikul mulk. He has authority over all things. He has ownership over all things. Everything in this life is created by Allah Azza wa Jalla, and it all belongs to Him. He has authority over it. He has authority over it. And He is the one who says what should be done, when the sun should come up and when it should go down. Likewise, just as He has that command universally, He has the legislative command and authority. And He says when you should prostrate and when you should stand, and when you should make ruku' and when you should bow, and when you should recite and when you should not recite, and when you should give wealth and when you should not, and what wealth you should give and how it should be given, and what day you should eat and what day you shouldn't eat, or what can you eat and what can you not eat. All of these things have been legislated by the Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's in His hands alone. He's the Creator. Allah ya'lamu man khalaq. Does not the Creator know? He knows best. So if a person wants to have peace in his life, then let him submit to the Creator, because the Creator knows best. Hadha huwa al-Islam. Al-Istislam lillahi. بالتوحيد, to submit and surrender to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we look at His rububiyyah and His lordship, and we see He created all things and brought it into existence and gave everything its shape and its form subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then likewise we see that it all belongs to Him under His command and under His authority tabaraka wa ta'ala, and then we look at not only that, He is the best creator. Everything He's created, He created in the best way. And the best manner, look at your hands, how beneficial they are. And the best manner He created insan. بِأَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. And the best manner He created the sun and the moon, how beneficial it is for our life. And the best manner He created the trees, and He disposes of the affairs of all things. And the best manner, subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-mudabbir. The people's feet, how do they come first? When he's a baby, they're small. What size are they now? 10 and a half. 11. How did they get there? All of a sudden he has a big foot. La, Allah Azza wa Jalla, He causes the foot to grow proportionally. In the same way the mind, in the same way the eyes, in the same way the understanding, all of this. So not only subhanAllah, He is the creator and the disposer of the affairs, but also He is the one who is doing it in the best manner. The lights come like a switch. Fajr is like a switch. La, it comes peacefully, gently, in harmony, little by little, and then the daytime comes. And likewise, the nighttime comes. All of this is from the beautiful, the perfect creation of Allah Azza wa Jalla. All of this is from His rububiyyah. If you want to know Allah Azza wa Jalla, look into His creation. Look into His creation. Lahu ayat fi khalqihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ اللَّيْلُ وَالنَّهَارُ وَالشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ لَا تَسْجُدُوا لِلشَّمْسِ وَلَا لِلْقَمَرِ وَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ الَّذِي خَلَقَهُنَّ إِن كُنتُمْ إِيَّاهُ تَعْبُدُونَ. The signs in the heavens and the earth and in the night and the day, signs in your own self. Signs in your own self. If we look at our own soul and our own bodies, there are signs. This is all from the rububiyyah of Allah Azza wa Jalla. There's likewise signs in His legislation, signs in His book, and signs in His deen that indicate His greatness subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is from the rububiyyah. So the author, he said, As-salallaha al-kareem, Rabb al-arsh al-azim. If we remember one thing, who is the Rabb? Three words. Who is the Rabb? Al-khaliq, al-malik, al-mudabbir. The rububiyyah, it tells three things. Every Muslim must know this. Every Muslim must know this and know it well. Every Muslim should know these principles. Basically everything that we learn in these classes, inshallah, they should be from those things that we have to know. I will focus on these things that, and give detail to these and importance to these issues that every Muslim, they should know absolutely. You should know it. If we know these things, we will be steadfast in our religion, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. If we know them and we apply them, and then likewise, we'll be able to call others. Just by learning these things and learning who is Allah and learning about His rububiyyah, if you know it well, you can call others to that. You can, in the limits of your knowledge. You say, you Muslims, what do you guys believe in? They say, some people, they say, you believe in a moon god. They say, you worship the moon, right? That's what they say. They see the moon on some of the signs, on some of the masajid. They say they worship the moon god. Or they say this, or they say that. Many Muslims, they can't even explain the belief in Allah Azza wa Jal. But this is incumbent upon everyone to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rabb, the Rububiyyah, it has three, it tells three ideas. What is it? Three meanings. That He created all things. Al-Khalq. And that all things that He created belong to Him. Al-Mulk. And that He is the one who is disposing of the affairs of His creation and that which He owns. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is disposing of the affairs of all things. The souls, the fruits, the trees, the seeds, the plants, the bird, the seas, and the water. All of these things, Allah Azza wa Jal created them and they belong to Him and He is disposing of their affairs in the best manner. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the Rububiyyah of Allah Azza wa Jal. Ar-Rabb, it comes from a root word. The Masdar. What word is that? That's the Jidr Nam, but there's a Tarbiyyah. Tarbiyyah. Tarbiyyah, to cultivate. To cultivate and to raise. The Rabb is the one who He is nourishing and providing for all things. Al-Imam al-Sidi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned a great benefit in the first of his tafsir about the tarbiyah of Allah Azza wa Jal. We read, he says, وَتَرْبِيَتُهُ تَعَالَى لِخَلْقِهِ نَوْعَانِ وَتَرْبِيَتُهُ تَعَالَى لِخَلْقِهِ نَوْعَانِ The rububiyah or the tarbiyah, the nourishment and the cultivation, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He raises and He brings up His creation and He nourishes His creation. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He has concern and care, cherishing His creation. Subhanahu wa ta'ala is two types. Ammatun wa khasa. One that is general and one that is specific. He says, فَالْعَمَّةُ هِيَ خَلْقُهُ لِلْمَخْلُقِينَ وَرَزْقُهُمْ وَهِدَايَتُهُمْ لِمَا فِيهِ مَصَارِحُهُمْ أَلَتِي فِيهَا بَقَاؤُهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا. He said that this general rububiyyah or tarbiyyah, cultivation and nourishment and cherishing and care that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives for His creation is general and specific. The general type is the fact that He created all things and that He provides for all things. Where does the bird get the food from? The elephant get the food from? The plant get the food from? How is the earth here? What is the Allah is providing for all things. He created all things and providing for its existence. Al-Hayyul Al-Qayyum. Now, so He is the one who is providing for all things, created all things, and He has guided all things likewise. Guided all things likewise to that which is most beneficial for it to remain in this life. Also from the names of Allah Azza wa Jalla, Al-Hadi. Al-Hadi. And also His Hidayah is two types also. As we see here, though, He is the one who khalaqa fahada. He created all things and He guided. He guided all things. For example, there are some animals, as soon as they're born, they land on their feet and they walk. Human being doesn't do that. Some animals, they land, like for example, a camel or a cow or horses, they land on their feet and they walk. They're born in this manner. They're born in this manner. This is how Allah, how does he know how to walk? Allah guided him. What about if you think about, for example, the ants? We see the ants. How do they live? They go so far and come back and they never get lost. This is from the guidance. Allah Azza wa Jalla, Ar-Rabb. He is guiding them and He is nourishing them and He is providing for them. He is inspiring for them to do that which is beneficial for them in their life. So they can live. Likewise, for example, the bee. Sometimes the bee, the scientists say that maybe he will fly over miles and miles and miles till he finds the proper pollen that he's looking for. And then it flies back, it doesn't get lost. It doesn't get lost. In the same way, He has a specific guidance. And the Rabb, He says here, the al-rububiyyah, our tarbiyyah al-khasa, from His guidance likewise, al-khasa, tarbiyyatuhu li-awliyaihi, fayurabbihim bil-imani, wa yuwaffiquhum lahu, wa yukammiluhum. He said, as for the specific tarbiyyah, cultivation and nourishment, subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is for His awliya. For those who believe in Him and for those whom He loves, for those who are His allies and those who believe in Him, the believers, al-awliya. He says, so He raises them and cultivates them and cherishes them and provides them with iman. And He gives them success to have faith in Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He completes them by way of that. ويدفع عنهم السوارف والعوائق الحائلة بينه وبينه بينهم وبينه. And he also removes those things that stop and block and turn him away from, turn them away from him, and turn them away from him. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's guided the people to know. If a person, he looks in his life, he will see that it was from the guidance of Allah. How many times a person was supposed to do something and something else happened, and because of that, he came to the masjid and he was guided. Or the events leading up to his life and how it was calamity and chaos, and then he met one individual and from him a light came, guiding him to the straight path. He heard one statement or read one book, or he heard one lecture, after that the guidance came. But before that it was complete chaos, and there's no way he knows in his life, there's no way he could have been guided himself. Rather, it came from Allah. Some, maybe he was upon innovation before, maybe he was upon sins before, maybe he had a sin he could not leave, and Allah guided him to leave it. This is from the specific tarbiyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the specific tarbiyah of Allah azza wa jalla, Ar-Rabb, that He guides and He raises His servants, that He selects them and chooses for them. Iman. He guides them to belief. He guides them to belief. He guides them so that they will not be lost. Maybe at one time they were lost, and then He subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rahim, Al-Kareem, Al-Hadi, Ar-Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala, He guided them. He guided them. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. This is the tarbiyah that Shaykh Abdurrahman al-Sidi is mentioning, al-khasa, li-awliya'illahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, وَحَقِيقَتُهَا تَرْبِيَةُ التَّوْفِيقَ لِكُلِّ خَيْرٍ وَالْإِسْمَةُ مِنْ كُلِّ شَرٍ. The reality of this type of tarbiyah, the specific tarbiyah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that He will give someone the success to do good, to do all of the good, to believe properly, to apply the belief properly, to stay away from the sins. Likewise, he says, وَالْإِسْمَةُ مِنْ كُلِّ شَرٍ, to be safe from every evil. It's from the success of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the Lord. He mentioned here a very beautiful, beautiful benefit. He said, وَلَعَلَّ هَذَا الْمَعْنَى هُوَ السِّرُّ فِي كَوْنِ أَكْثَرِ أَدْعِيَةِ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ بِلَفْظِ الرَّبِّ. He said, and because of this meaning here, that this is perhaps the secret behind the fact that the majority of the supplications of the prophets is with the term Ar-Rabb. You find in the Quran that many of the supplications Allah mentioned from His prophets, that they call on Him with Rabb. Rabb, Rabbana atina fi dunya. Many, Rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana. Many of the supplications in the Quran, they begin like this, with Rabb, calling on Allah Azza wa Jalla by Ar-Rabb. He said, because فَإِنَّ مَطَالِبَهُمْ كُلَّهَا دَاخِلَةٌ تَحْتَ رُبُوبِيَتِهِ الْخَاصَةِ. So this is the secret from that. Ar-Rabb, He is the one that can give them what they ask for. The one that is making a supplication for anything, Ar-Rabb, He is the one who cherishes and sustains, and He is the one who guides, and He is the one who blesses, and He gives benefit, and He protects from harm. Ar-Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala. So calling on Him by that name is from the methodology of the prophets, and they did that a lot because of this meaning, that He has that specific tarbiyah, and ya Rabb, that to guide me, to guide my heart, to help my family believe, to guide my mother to Islam, to make me firm in on the straight path, to provide for me in this life and in the hereafter. Ya Rabb, to call on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this name is a great way to worship and draw near to Him. To call on Him by all of His names, this is the way. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. Allah has the most beautiful names, so call on Him by way of them. This is the tawheed of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the tawheed and the deen of al-Islam that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came with. Alhamdulillah that Allah guided us to Islam. So the author, he mentioned, أَسْأَلُ اللَّهِ الْكَرِيمِ رَبَّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ. What is the arsh? The arsh, Shaykh Ibn Baz, he was asked about that, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned, he said, الْعَرْشُ عِنْدَ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ فِي اللُّغَةِ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ هُوَ الْكُرْسِي الْكُرْسِي الْعَظِيمِ Kursi al-Malik. He said the Arsh in the Arabic language, according to the scholars of the Arabic language, meaning linguistically, it is a great, great, great chair. And it's the chair of a king, meaning it's a throne. And linguistically, al-Arsh. He said, وَالْمُرَادُ بِعَرْشِ الرَّحْمَنِ كُرْسِيٌ عَظِيمٌ هُوَ أَعْظَمُ الْمَخْلُقَاتِ. And he said, رَحِمَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, that the intent by the Arsh of Ar-Rahman, it is a great, great throne. And it is the greatest creation, the greatest of all creations, the greatest of all creation, the largest. لو قوائم Walahu hamala. It has those who carry it. It has carry those who carry it. Min al malaika yahmilunahu. There are those who carry it from the angels. They carry it. They're carrying it. Subhanallah. Wallahu fawq al arsh. And he says, in Allah Azza wa Jal, He's above the throne. And meaning in a manner befitting His Majesty Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. كما قال عز وجل الرحمن على العرش استوى وقال سبحانه إن ربكم الله الذي خلق السماوات والأرض في ستة أيام ثم استوى على العرش. And this is the way the author here, he is drawing near to Allah عز وجل by mentioning these names. أسأل الله الكريم رب العرش العظيم to do what? And then he said, after this, and he ordered this, this is how he's calling on Allah Azza wa Jal. And then he says, "And yatawallaka fi dunya wal akhirah," that He protect you, at-tawalli, and He to protect, wal hifdhu wa tasdeed wa tawfiq, that He would protect and give success and direct someone in this life into the hereafter. A great, great, great supplication. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to make similar supplication like this in the night prayer. In which prayer? In which dua? Dua? Al-Qunut. وَتَوَلَّنِي فِي مَنْ تَوَلَّيْتِ. Naam, this is what he's asking here, similar. And يَتَوَلَّاكَ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. I'm asking Allah, the most generous and kind, the Lord of the great, great throne, that He protect you in this life and in the hereafter. If Allah protects a person in this life, He will be protected from all types of evils, from misguidance. He will be protected from even from sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He would take care of His affairs for him. From the names of Allah Azza wa Jalla, likewise, Al-Wali, Wal-Mawla, Al-Wali, the one who takes the charge and command of the affairs of the believers. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ مَوْلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَأَنَّ الْكَافِرِينَ لَا مَوْلَى لَهُمْ. Allah, He mentioned that this is because the believers, why did the believers have success? Because Allah is their Mawla, Allah is their guardian and protector, Allah is their Lord, and the disbelievers, they have no guardian. They have no guardian or protector. Now this is the case. And يَتَوَلَّكَ أَنْ يَكُنْ وَلِيًا لَكَ. That He will be in charge of your affairs, protecting you and taking care of everything for you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to seek refuge from not being under the care of Allah Azza wa Jal, from being entrusted to his own self. وَلَا تَكِلْنِي إِلَى نَفْسِي طَرْفَةَ عَيْنِ. He would say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do not entrust me to myself for the blinking of an eye. Before that, this is the ulama, they would mention, this is the dua of al-karb, the dua of what is karb? Distress. The dua of distress. What would he say? Also calling on Allah by His names and by His attributes. اللَّهُمَّ رَحْمَتَكَ نَرْجُو. فَلَا تَكِلْنَا إِلَىٰ أَنفُسِنَا طَرْفَةَ عَيْنِ وَأَصْلِحْ لَنَا شَأْنَنَا كُلَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. This is the deen of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, calling on Allah alone by His names and His attributes. Dua karb. This is the dua the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say in the time of distress. But sometimes a believer, he may be safe in his home, he may be safe in his car, in his street, or in his masjid, but he will be in distress, afraid that his heart might go astray. Call on Allah sincerely. Allahumma rahmataka narju. فَلَا تَكِلْنَا إِلَىٰ أَنفُسِنَا طَرْفَةَ عَيْنٍ. Do not leave us to our own selves for the blinking of an eye. Yani, be our wali. Be our wali, or mawla, our rabb. Take care of our affairs for us. Do not leave us to ourselves. Do not leave us to ourselves. If we're left to ourselves, we're weak. We can't do anything. We can't do anything. That's why we began in the name of Allah. Bismillah. Bismillah. He says, أَنْ يَتَوَلَّاكَ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. If He also is your wali in the hereafter, then you'll be safe on the sirat, and you'll be safe on that day when the people are being exposed. Many people, they'll be exposed on the day of resurrection in front of everyone, in front of the creation. Those people who showed off, they'll be exposed. Those people who worship Allah Azza wa Jalla without ikhlas, they'll be exposed. Those people who are hypocrites, they will not be able to bow. There will be calamities. There will be people on the day of resurrection, they betrayed people. They will come with a flag coming from their bottoms. Akramakum Allah. هَذَا غَدْرُ فُلَانٍ وَفُلَانٍ. They say, this is the betrayer, so-and-so, the son of so-and-so. People will come in many different states on the day of resurrection. But the one who Allah is His wali, he will come safely. And he will come protected. You have the protection of the Mawla subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ يَجْعَلَكَ مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتَ. What a great, great dua that He has made for us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept it from Him in our right. سبحانه وتعالى سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.